Conduct the session 2 of this Metal Speaks program. This will be on membranous nephropathy, a case-based approach. And this is an educational endeavor developed by us under the guidance of Dr. Vijay Kesar and his NGO, Kidney Education and Research Network. The objective of this program is actually imparting the knowledge and insights of eminent nephrologists from across the country to the students of DM and DNB Nephro, especially who are in their second or third year and about to move to the next phase of their academic or professional life. The mentors will help the students in finding solution to their unmet needs, ranging from their curriculum to their queries related to setting up their clinic and medical legal issues linked to it. The flow of the event is as follows. So it will be a session of 1 hour duration, and it will be conducted fortnightly on Fridays. So the presentation will be consisting of a 20 minute duration with a case scenario discussion of 10 minutes and a question answer session followed by the discussion for 30 minutes. So I request you all to please put your questions on the chat box so that you can receive the guidance and insights from the eminent nephrologist. On this note, I take this privilege in welcoming the course coordinator of our program, Professor Dr. Vijay Kesar. He is President, Kidney Education and Research Network, Chairman, Medanta Kidney and Urology Institute, Division of Nephrology and Kidney Transplant Medicine, Medanta the Medicity. Sir is also Regional Coordinator, Research South Asia, International Society of Nephrology. He is Inspector for DNB and DM Recognition for National Board of Examination and Medical Council of India. Sir has set up successful nephrology departments at SKIMS, Srinagar, SGPGI, Lucknow, Apollo, New Delhi, Fortis, New Delhi, and Medanta, Gurugram. I also take this privilege in welcoming the moderator for today's session, Dr. Rajapurkar sir. Sir is Director of Postgraduate Studies and Research, Mulzibhai Patel Urological Hospital, Nadiad. He is Honorable Medical Director and Member, Board of Governors, Mulzibhai Patel Society for Research in Nephro Urology, Nadiad. He is a recognized teacher in nephrology for training students for DNB since November 1992. So on this note, I request Dr. Rajapurkar sir to please take over the proceeding. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much. I really don't have any slides or some such thing. Membranous nephropathy, as most of you know, is very, very common condition in patients who present as nephrotic syndrome in adults. Came from very early days during my training, we used to use only symptomatic treatment, and rarely an occasional patient would get well. Now, but a lot of immunosuppressive therapy of different types, and we don't know what to choose from and how to go about. Also, even today, there are some very difficult patients where it is not easy to decide on even day-to-day basis as to what is the best form of therapy to use, how much to investigate, how costly it is to investigate, how reliable are these tests that we do and ask for. So I think we couldn't have had a better speaker today than Dr. Raja Ramachandran, who has his own publications in the area of membranous nephropathy in very reputed journals. Also, he is active researcher in this field and comes from the institute from where a lot of these publications have come. They followed this cohort for many, many years. So I think without coming between Raja and all of you, I request Raja to please go ahead with his presentation. Raja, please.
Thank you, sir. Yeah. Good evening, all of you. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, yeah. You are.
Thank you.
Clear. And
okay.
Your screen can be seen.
Thank you. Thank you so much. So I would thank you, sir, for the humble introduction. And I thank Professor Kher, sir, for, you know, asking me to speak on the topic. So I'll directly go into the topic where I will be discussing primary membranous nephropathy using various clinical scenarios, the questions using various clinical scenarios. So coming to my first slide, this was a tweet which was shared by a nephrologist from the US. Most of the followers agreed upon the top 10 developments that happened in the nephrology. You all can see that PLA2R in primary membranous nephropathy is right there at number 2 in position. With fair degree of certainty, I can say that the discovery of PLA2R by Beck and colleagues have revolutionized the diagnosis and management of primary membranous nephropathy. Primary membranous nephropathy is an autoimmune disease consequential to the alloimmunization of the podocyte antigen, namely PLA2R, thrombospondylin 7A domain, etc. The antibodies towards these antigen, after they pass through the basement membrane, attach to the podocyte antigen, incite complement activation, and then there is a further damage to the glomerular filtration barrier, resulting in proteinuria and, you know, subsequent chronic kidney disease. The slide displays the sequence in which the podocyte antigens were identified. The PLA2R work was published in 2009, which is almost a decade ago. A lot is known over the last one decade. The latest addition to it is the exostosin 1 and 2 and the neural epidermal growth factor in secondary and pediatric or malignancy associated membranous nephropathy by Sethi and his colleagues. Coming to what is phospholipase A2 receptor is, it is a 182 kilodalton protein which is present on the podocytes. It is seemingly expressed on the podocytes. However, in patients with membranous nephropathy, because of stimulus, there is an exaggerated expression of PLA2R. The PLA2R molecule contains of 10 extracellular domains. The 10 extracellular domains are the cystine-rich domain 1, fibronectin type 2 domain, that is the second one, and there are 8 more C-type lectin domains which are labeled 1 to 8. The autoantibodies are commonly to the cystine-rich domain. However, with the passage of the disease, there could be a switch from one domain to the other in patients with persistent disease. The presence of either autoantibodies or enhanced staining for PLA2R is considered as PLA2R-related membranous nephropathy. The autoantibodies are positive in 2/3 to 3/4 of the patients, depending upon the which race or region they belong to. It's high in the Caucasians and low in the Japanese cohort. Autoantibodies are, the enhanced staining for PLA2R is positive in about 80% of the patients. It is a general perception that about 15% of the membranous nephropathy is PLA2R unrelated. So after this brief introduction, I will take you across 5 clinical scenarios. And what are the 5 clinical scenarios? One is anti-PLA2R antibody assessment, a substitute to kidney biopsy to diagnose primary membranous nephropathy. Second, is there any relevance of tissue staining? Third, is there a role of anti-PLA2R in guiding therapy? Fourth, is membranous in HCV patient always HCV related? This was a question asked by one of the attendees. The last is, what is the role of rituximab in primary membranous nephropathy? So coming to the diagnostic utility. So before we go to the clinical scenario, so you can all take this question and, you know, all the answers are right. So in your routine practice, do you substitute anti-PLA2R assessment for a renal biopsy to diagnose PLA2R related membranous nephropathy? So the answers could be, yes, this facility is not available or not affordable to most of the patients. Yes, this could be one possibility. Yes, we do it routinely. Third, no, I do a biopsy only to diagnose primary membranous nephropathy. Fourth is, it's used as a substitute as a serology to a biopsy in patients with contraindications to biopsy. So coming to the case, a 38-year-old daily wage worker presented with pedal edema of 4-month duration and anasarca of 15 days. Patient did not have any feature suggestive of secondary membranous nephropathy. The patient was normotensive and on evaluation had massive proteinuria of 7.5 grams with hypoalbuminemia and normal renal functions. So on examination, the patient had anasarca and nephrotic syndrome. On ultrasound examination, the patient had a contracted left side kidney, which is the usual site of biopsies. Probably he had a stone and probably it was a chronic pyelonephritic kidney. The patient also developed a deep vein thrombosis of the left upper limb on the day of biopsy. And we decided to biopsy him on the right side. However, on the day of biopsy, he developed a deep vein thrombosis of the left upper limb. He was started on vitamin K antagonist. So sometime back, I carried a Twitter survey of the same clinical case on how one would approach this case, whether they would give unfractionated heparin and then biopsy this patient, or would get an anti-PLA2 or antibody and then decide whether to go ahead if it is positive or to biopsy if it is negative. 55% of the attendees, they decided that they would base their decision on anti-PLA2R assessment. And I think that is what we also did. The anti-PLA2R assessment was done, which was positive, which was about 70 reference unit per ml on an ELISA testing. And within 1 month, the patient started to show a reduction in his titers. Patient completed 5 more months of immunosuppressive therapy. At the end of 2 months, the patient achieved serological remission. The serological remission was also paralleled by reduction in proteinuria and inversely with an improvement in serum albumin. Throughout the course, patient had normal renal function with a last estimated GFR of about 88 ml per minute per 1.73 meter squared. So now we shall go to the brief review of literature. There are a lot of studies. You know, I would only focus on 3 main studies. The first is a meta-analysis by Day et al., which included 19 studies with over 1,100 patients, which concluded that PLA2R antibody assessment is very specific for paramembranous nephropathy. The specificity was over 95% and the sensitivity was poor, it was 70%. Also, the authors suggest that anti-PLA2R has a diagnostic value and should be interpreted always with a clinical finding. There is a recently published article in Kidney International from the Mayo Group. 838 patients underwent an anti-PLA2R assessment, of which 143 were positive for antibodies, both by indirect immunofluorescence and ELISA. 97 patients had positive serology with native biopsy suggestive of primary membranous nephropathy and negative for secondary workup. 60% of the patients had normal renal function and 40% of them had renal dysfunction. The authors observed that the patients who had normal renal functions and anti-PLA2R both by ELISA and indirect immunofluorescence, no secondary causes, the biopsy revealed only membranous nephropathy without altering the management. So the take-home message was, in patients with normal renal function and the clinical scenario completely compatible with membranous nephropathy, anti-PLA2R is a reliable method to diagnose primary membranous nephropathy. There was an excellent editorial review by Professor Brad Robin, who went on to state that PLA2R antibody assessment is accurate for primary membranous nephropathy and is a reasonable to use it for the diagnosis in patients who have an exaggerated harm from a biopsy. The next study is from the German group, where 263 patients with primary membranous nephropathy underwent renal biopsy. 194 of them were PLA2R related. Of the 194, only 12 patients had an additional diagnosis. 5 of them had interstitial nephritis, 5 had diabetic nephropathy, and 2 had IgA nephropathy. And of the 12 patients, 10 of them had renal dysfunction. Only 2 patients with IgA nephropathy did not have renal dysfunction. Both arteriosclerosis and segmental sclerosis were higher in 12 patients with additional diagnosis. The authors concluded that 6% of the PLA2R positive membranous nephropathy would have an additional diagnosis. And in patients with autoantibodies and nephrotic syndrome, we need to individualize. Biopsy may be performed if no risk of complications. The conclusion of the Mayo group and the German group is same. The patients with nephrotic syndrome, normal renal functions, PLA2R may be used to diagnose primary membranous nephropathy. So before we go to the next part, a word of caution. No matter which modality you use to diagnose membranous nephropathy, biopsy or serology, the age-related screening for malignancy should always be undertaken. Need to rule out connective tissue disorders and hepatotropic viral infections. So whether the concluding side is whether anti-PLA2R could replace a kidney biopsy in diagnosing primary membranous nephropathy. Well, in a low risk setting, where there is a high risk of biopsy morbidity, like patients on anticoagulation, patients who are sick, patients who cannot lie down. So in that setting, anti-PLA2R assessment could replace a kidney biopsy to diagnose primary membranous nephropathy. The next is, after the serology, then we go to the tissue staining. Is the tissue staining of any utility and relevant? In renal biopsies, we see for exaggerated staining for PLA2R in the podocytes. The PLA2R are very sparsely expressed in a normal glomeruli. In patients with membranous nephropathy, because of what reason, we really do not know, there is an exaggerated expression of PLA2R, which binds to the PLA2R antibodies, which comes from the circulation. We stain the PLA2R antigen and not the antigen antibody complex. So here we had a 55-year-old small scale businessman. So well, he was dealing with hand sanitizer and gloves in 2012. I'm sure he's a rich man now. Presented with pedal edema and hypertension of 2-year duration. The patient was started on amlodipine and telmisartan. Did not undergo an evaluation for edema as it was passed on as CCB related edema. Not an uncommon scenario. Minimal edema is always seen. Minimal edema can be seen in patients with amlodipine and is passed on as normal. Though personally, I would sit back only after getting an assurance of normal urine albumin. Patient had a 4+ albinuria with a proteinuria of 6.3 grams a day. Biopsy revealed PLA2R positive MN. However, the anti-PLA2R was negative both by ELISA and the indirect immunofluorescence. This was done as a part of a project. The patient was started on tacrolimus and steroid as a part of a trial. The patient had remission at 6 months, only to relapse at 12 months. We repeated his anti-PLA2R, the one in the red. His anti-PLA2R, which was negative to begin with, was positive at 12 months, which was almost 10 times the value. The value is about 14 reference units, is less than 14 reference units is the normal limit, and it was 160 in the given patients. Patient was treated with cyclical cyclophosphamide and steroids. Patient achieved clinical and immunological remission. Patient did have a relapse, both clinically and immunologically, at 42 months, which silenced, luckily, with spontaneous remission without need of any other therapy. Coming to the distinct teaching point, is tissue staining relevant? Patients with PLA2R related MN can have undetectable antibodies in the beginning, as they tend to saturate the podocyte, what is called as a sink phenomenon. So the autoantibodies appear in circulation after they have saturated the kidneys. And the patients who have tissue positivity and serum negativity, there can be because of two reasons. One is the sink hypothesis, which I mentioned. The second is patient would have achieved a serological remission. And if the patient have an unabated proteinuria despite negative PLA2R, it is advisable to repeat an antibody assessment at second or the third month. So coming to the third part, which is the clinical activity, is the PLA2R pathogenic? We actually do not have an animal model for PLA2R associated membranous nephropathy. Recurrence of membranous nephropathy post-transplant or a recent depiction of a transplantal transfer of PLA2R and proteinuria and hypoalbuminemia in a neonate are suggestive of the pathogenicity. The current figure is a pictorial representation of the natural history of primary membranous nephropathy. There is alloimmunization to begin with, and then there is appearance of anti-PLA2R in the circulation, which gets adsorbed in the kidney, followed by clinical activity in the form of proteinuria. on starting the immunosuppression or spontaneously, there is immunological remission, which is succeeded by a clinical remission. During the relapse, the entire cycle is repeated. Sorry for the busy slide. The table is a summary of studies of anti-PLA2R and clinical activity. The conclusion from the studies are immunological remission precedes clinical remission, and it may be by 2 to 11 months. Spontaneous remission is less likely in patients with high anti-PLA2R titers by ELISA. Antibody at the end of 6 to 12 months predicts the clinical course. In patients treated with cyclical cyclophosphamide and steroids, immunological remission may begin way early at 1 month and peaks about 3 months of starting therapy. In patients treated with rituximab, low antibody titer at treatment initiation and disappearance of antibody at 3rd month predicts remission. So now we shall go to the clinical scenario of how we use the anti-PLA2R in managing the patients. A 52-year-old nurse from the Patna Medical College had presented with history of pedal edema, underwent a renal biopsy for nephrotic syndrome, and was diagnosed with parenchymal membranous nephropathy. The patient was on an antiproteinuric treatment for 15 months with no reduction in proteinuria. Patient on self-referral came to our unit. As the patient received good antiproteinuric treatment, we decided to start cyclical cyclophosphamide and steroids. The patient's anti-PLA2R at the start of therapy was 223 reference unit per ml. At the end of 6 months of therapy, the patient continued to have nephrotic range proteinuria, as you can see, 7.72 grams. Our dilemma was to wait or to plan second-line agents like rituximab. So we decided to bank our decision on PLA2R antibody assessment. As a part of our registry, we had banked her monthly samples. On the assessment of the 6 samples, we realized that the patient had achieved immunological remission at the end of 1st month itself and was persistently negative. Hence, we decided to continue only losartan and statins. The patient achieved partial remission by the month 9, 2.9 grams, and then a complete remission by 24 months. You can see 230 milligrams a day. So the assessment of anti-PLA2R prevented us from starting a second-line agent. Otherwise, the credit of remission would have been conveniently passed to the second drug. Well, this is on a lighter note, but certainly the patient did not get exposed to the second line immunosuppressive agents, which could have been potentially toxic. The next case is a 20-year-old college girl who is a known case of celiac disease, had history of pedal edema, though minimal, for 8 months, along with hypertension, was started on enalapril, and biopsy was done to know the cause of nephrotic syndrome. The diagnosis was confirmed as PLA2R-related membranous nephropathy, and the titer of antibody was 120 reference units. Considering her young age of 20 years and proteinuria of over 8 grams, we advised her rituximab therapy. However, patient belonged to an impoverished background and was unsuccessful in arranging finances for rituximab. We then decided to treat her with cyclical cyclophosphamide and glucocorticoid therapy with an anti-PLA2R monitoring. We carried out our monthly assessment of anti-PLA2R antibody. The samples were assessed right from 4th month onwards. As the 2nd month sample was negative, the patient was continued for 1 more month of immunosuppression and then stopped when there were 2 anti-PLA2R negative. Currently, we report the 24-month follow-up of the patient with complete remission of the nephrotic state. So the patient received only 2 months of steroids and 1 month of cyclophosphamide. There was 50% reduction in the dose of immunosuppressive therapy delivered to the patient. So the distinct teaching point is, anti-PLA2R monitoring relevant? Yes, antibody has an excellent association with clinical activity, may be valuable for monitoring and follow-up. So the next question is, are all membranous nephropathy in hepatitis C positive patients related to infection? So I would demonstrate 2 cases, and there is teaching points in both of them. There's a 58-year-old housewife presented with pedal edema of 5 months duration, evaluated and found to have a proteinuria of 2.89 grams and hypoalbuminemia. Kidney biopsy was suggestive of membranous nephropathy, and her anti-HCV was positive. We then tested her for HCV RNA. The patient had a high viral load. The PLA2R staining was positive on the glomeruli. The patient was started on sofosbuvir and ribavirin. the patient achieved rapid and sustained virological remission. But however, despite the virological remission, the patient continued to have an unabated proteinuria. So we went ahead and tested her pre and post sofosbuvir sample for anti-PLA2R in our repository, and we found that both of them, 236 and 117, like both the samples were positive. So we decided to treat the patients with cyclical cyclophosphamide and steroids as we had given sufficient washout period. The patient achieved both immunological and clinical remission. Now we have the 24 months follow-up of the patient. The patient continues to have partial remission, that is about 680 milligrams a day with a negative anti-PLA2R and a HCV RNA. So the next patient is a 50-year-old male who presented with pedal edema of 14-month duration with hypertension, was seen by his local physician and was prescribed chlorothalidone and enalapril. As the edema didn't subside, the patient decided to see us. We diagnosed him with nephrotic syndrome and biopsy suggestive of primary membranous nephropathy. The biopsy did not stain for PLA2R antibody or the antigen. On workup for secondary causes, the patient tested positive for hepatitis C. Therapy. And now the patient achieved both clinical remission and the patient achieved clinical remission at the end of 3 months along with virological response. It is now 24 months and the patient continues to be in clinical remission with a negative HCV RNA. So coming to the brief review of literature, this is the report from the Roncos group, which report two similar patients but with hepatitis B positivity. The patient continued to have proteinuria despite antiviral treatment and tested positive for anti-PLA2R antibodies. Both the patients were treated with rituximab with a favorable outcome. There are multiple reports from the mainland China on the presence of anti-PLA2R in patients with secondary membranous nephropathy. Also, some groups have gone on to describe up to 10% of patients with lupus nephritis may also have anti-PLA2R antibodies. So, the distinct teaching point is in patients with chronic hepatitis B or C and primary membranous nephropathy, the viral infection could well be the trigger for aluminization, and antiviral should be the first line of management. You should ensure a successful virological response. Immunosuppressive therapy only if the nephrotic syndrome persists after the virological response. During and post immunosuppressive therapy, you need to monitor for viral load. So, next, or the last part, is the management of primary membranous nephropathy. Let me state few rules of management of primary membranous nephropathy. Always do an age-related screening, which may be just a simple ultrasound examination and chest X-ray examination in most of them. All the patients with low risk of membranous nephropathy, that is patients who do not have renal dysfunction or who do not have complications like DVT, recurrent infection, hospitalization for decongestion, should be given a 3 to 6 months period of antiproteinuric treatment. By this, you will be able to get all the low-lying fruits, and it is advisable to anticoagulate all patients with serum albumin of less than 2.8 gram per deciliter with no risk factors, or less than 2 to 2.5 in patients with high risk of bleed. Always give anticoagulation to patients who are likely to follow up regularly with you, otherwise they could present with catastrophic bleeds. So the question now is, what is your primary choice of immunosuppressive therapy in antiproteinuric resistant PMN? So one, these are the various options. I have not deliberately added MMF, although it's the most commonly prescribed drug in the country. First is cyclical cyclophosphamide and steroids. Second is CNIs, that is cyclosporine or tacrolimus with or without steroids. Rituximab, cyclical cyclophosphamide as the default treatment, and CNI or rituximab in patients who have contraindications like infertility issues or diabetes mellitus. So, you know, you could use any of these agents. I'll just try to, you know, take you through the various literature that is available. So, the first KDIGO 2012 guidelines on glomerulonephritis stated that, you know, they recommended cyclical cyclophosphamide and steroids as first-line management and CNIs in patients who have contraindication to, you know, the cyclical cyclophosphamide and steroids. And because why cyclophosphamide and steroids are recommended as a first-line agent is because we have long-term data with them. So this is a study by my mentor, Professor Vivekanand Jha, who had evaluated the long-term hard outcomes of primary membranous nephropathy treated with cyclical cyclophosphamide and steroids or no immunosuppressive therapy. At the end of 10 years, 73% of the patients who received immunosuppressive therapy were in remission, compared to only 35% of them who did not receive cyclical cyclophosphamide and steroids. The difference is very glaring and statistically significant. Also, the doubling of serum creatinine, dialysis, or death was reported in 21% of the patients in the immunosuppressive group versus 56% in the non-immunosuppressive arm. So based on this study and the study by Ponticelli et al., they recommended that the initial therapy should be a six-month course of alternative monthly cycles of oral and IV corticosteroids and oral alkylating agents, which could be cyclophosphamide or chlorambucil. So we reported the two-year outcome of patients who were randomized to receive cyclophosphamide and glucocorticoids or tacrolimus and steroids. The remission at the end of 12 months, if you see, is comparable between both the groups. However, the remission at the end of 18 and 24 months were inferior in the TAC group compared to the cyclophosphamide and steroids. The lower remission rates in the TAC group was primarily due to the high relapse on stopping the TAC therapy. So we have just completed the 6 years analysis, and the signals are clear that cyclical cyclophosphamide is way superior to tacrolimus with respect to proteinuric remission in patients with primary membranous nephropathy. Again, the inferior results with the CNI and steroids are because of the increased relapse rates. So what are the issues with cyclical cyclophosphamide and steroids? The most common complaint, which I would say is not an adverse event, is the steroid withdrawal symptoms, which is the most common symptoms. For a 70 kg man, after the three massive pulses, we start them on 35 milligrams of prednisolone. We stop the drug abruptly. So you need to counsel the patient for all the withdrawal symptoms. A decline in the appetite is the predominant symptom, and they often attribute it to cyclophosphamide, demonizing the drug further. Do explain the patients on steroid-related toxicity like diabetes mellitus and hypokalemia. Do not forget to add cotrimoxazole prophylaxis, and you may add other agents like fluconazole or acyclovir, depending on your regional protocol. Infertility is clearly a factor in middle-aged patients, especially the female subjects. Malignancy, hematological and bladder, are both dose-dependent. The study by the Wetzel group, which used cyclophosphamide for 1 year, they reported malignancy of 21 per 1,000 patient years in their regimen versus 4 in patients who received no cyclophosphamide. The mean dose of cyclophosphamide in the 1 year protocol is 37 grams compared to less than 13 grams in patients who received the cyclical cyclophosphamide and steroids. And in our 6 year follow-up, not a single patient have developed malignancy secondary to cyclophosphamide therapy. All said and done, I've heard experts criticizing the drug to the extent that they also called it a poison. Remember, as the poverty stats and facts of 2013, 50% of the world population lives on less than $2.5 a day. Hence, for a foreseeable future, the management of primary membranous nephropathy is going to be largely dependent on cyclophosphamide and steroids. Yes, it is indeed time to evaluate lower dose of cyclophosphamide and steroids in patients with primary membranous nephropathy. Quickly, we move on to the next drug, which is the rituximab, primarily a drug which was introduced to manage non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. So what are the various schedules of rituximab that one uses? One, the first is the lymphoma regimen, that is 375 milligram per meter squared into 4 doses. Second is the rheumatoid arthritis protocol, 1 gram on day 0 and 15, that is a fortnight protocol. Then the third one is the one used by the Rimutzi group, where they use a single dose of 375 milligrams per meter squared. The fourth is the Gemritix protocol, 375 milligrams per meter squared on day 0 and day 8. Then the fifth is something like a CD19 targeted approach, where you use 375 milligrams as a single dose. The second dose is based on CD19 and or PLA2R at timed intervals, maybe at second or third months in the sixth month. So we, if we have too many protocols, that means that we are not really sure which one really works. So I would go to the case. We had a 25-year-old college-going lady who is a known case of primary membranous nephropathy, who was previously treated with cyclical cyclophosphamide and steroids. After 3.5 years, patient had a relapse of the disease. The patient had massive proteinuria and severe hypoalbuminemia. And we decided to treat this patient with rituximab. The patient was administered two doses of rituximab. After an initial decline, there was a plateau of proteinuria. If you see at third month, it continued to remain at 3.9 to 4.25 grams. So we decided to repeat the PLA2R antibodies and also the CD19. We found that the patient's PLA2R antibody at the third month was 140 reference units, and also the CD19 was about 40 cells. Hence, we decided to give 500 milligrams of rituximab. The patients then had, if you see, a reduction in the proteinuria and achieved remission. The repeat PLA2R at the sixth month was negative. So coming to the review of literature, there are at least two randomized studies. The first study was from the French group by Dahan and Ronco et al., where 75 patients resistant to anti-proteinuric treatments were randomized to rituximab or only supportive care. The primary objective was to see remission at 6 months. At the end of 6 months, if you see, there was no difference in the remission rates. However, when these patients were followed up for an extended period of time, 2/3 of the rituximab-treated patients had remission compared to only 1/3 in the supportive arm. The difference in the immunological remission was startling when you compare the rituximab and the supportive arm. The adverse events you see are comparable in both the groups. The authors concluded that rituximab-induced remission occurred after 6 months, and PLA2R antibody is an early marker of rituximab effect. So next is a recently published study in the New England Journal of Medicine. This is the famous MENTOR trial. The authors included patients of primary membranous nephropathy with a lot of proteinuria from 22 sites across from United States and Canada. And the patients were refractory to RAS blockade, that is telmisartan or enalapril or amipril. They were 130 patients were randomized to receive either a fortnight protocol of rituximab with a top-up dosing at between 3 to 6 months, or cyclosporin with a trough level of 125 to 175 nanogram per ml. At the end of 12 months, their remission rates in the rituximab and in the cyclosporin group was 60% and 52% respectively. The authors concluded that rituximab is non-inferior to cyclosporin at the end of 1 year. When they extended the follow-up of 2 years, they found that 60% of the patients on rituximab maintained remission versus only 20% in the cyclosporin arm, leading to the conclusion that rituximab is superior to cyclosporin at the end of 24 months. The adverse event profile was better in rituximab as compared to the cyclosporin therapy. So the next is the report from Sweden. It is a very informative report. The authors reported that in patients with an anti-PLA2R titer of over 150, they responded poorly to rituximab. So probably in future, in patients who have high antibody titers, you need to deconstruct the titers. It means that it's not it only give on day 0 or day 15 or day 0 or day 8. You need to probably monitor at 3rd month and 6 months and systematically deconstruct the anti-PLA2R titers. So the present slide highlights our experience in managing membranous nephropathy with rituximab with two regimens. A total of 88 patients received rituximab therapy, of which 63 patients were given 1 gram on day 0 and day 15, and a repeat at 3 months if the CD19 counts were over 5 cells. In the CD19 targeted this group, the patients were given 375 milligrams per meter squared single dose and a repeat dosing at 3 months if the CD19 was greater than 5 cells, but the repeat dosing were only 100 milligrams. And after that, they were monitored for the CD19 cells. The proteinuria at the baseline and 12 months were comparable. And if you see, 2/3 of the patients in both the group responded favorably to therapy. The adverse event profile was similar. However, the CD19 targeted therapy was cost effective, as the median dose in the CD19 targeted therapy was 800 milligrams compared to 2 grams in the other group. So, is rituximab effective as a primary therapy? Yes, 2/3 of the patients seem to respond in between 12 to 18 months after rituximab infusion. Patients with anti-PLA2 are in third tertile. Third tertile means for Indian patients, it's over 200 reference units by ELISA, are less likely to respond to only the first shots of rituximab. They would require repeated infusion and deconstruction of the PLA2R titers. Have patients with rituximab, response may take really long time. We have seen patients responding after 24 months. So next, the data, the last part is, what is the role of various immunosuppressive in resistant and relapsing primary membranous nephropathy? So we reported 35 patients with relapsing or resistant membranous nephropathy treated with various regimens. The reduction in the anti-PLA2R in relapsing or resistant primary membranous nephropathy was best with cyclophosphamide and steroids, followed by rituximab. Tacrolimus seems to be largely an ineffective in this cohort of patients. Patients with antibody in the third tertile responded poorly to treatment as compared to those in the first and the second tertile. So in patients with resistant disease, you know, the first choice of agent could be cyclical cyclophosphamide and steroids, followed by rituximab, and a word of caution for the use of CNIs. Tacrolimus should be avoided as a rescue regimen in patients with resistant primary membranous nephropathy. So coming to the take-home message, that's my last slide. So what did we learn from various case scenario? Is anti-PLA2R a substitute to renal biopsy to diagnose primary membranous nephropathy? Yes. In patients with normal renal functions and those who have contraindication or an exaggerated risk of complications by a biopsy, you may use antibody to diagnose. What is the relevance of tissue staining? In patients who are anti-PLA2R negative, tissue PLA2R helps in better characterization of primary membranous nephropathy and also may help you in repeating the anti-PLA2R if the patients have not responding to the therapy. Role of anti-PLA2R in guiding therapy. PLA2R is valuable in disease monitoring and follow-up, especially before choosing the second-line agent in a resistant case or when you plan a PLA2R targeted treatment. Is membranous nephropathy in hepatitis B or C always hepatitis B, C related? Yes, if the nephrotic syndrome does not respond to antiviral treatment, it is advised to get antibody assessment and then subsequent immunosuppressive treatment. You need to monitor the viral load before and after, during and after the immunosuppressive therapy. Role of rituximab in primary membranous nephropathy? Yes, rituximab is slowly the first line, going to be the first line agent for the management of primary membranous nephropathy. It takes a longer time to respond compared to cyclophosphamide and steroids. Maybe worthwhile to give additional doses in patients who do not respond to the first doses of rituximab. Thank you all for a patient here. Yeah.
Raja, as expected, an excellent presentation. And congratulations on the amount of work done by your institute in this field. It appears that you have studies and patients in almost all types of regimes of membranous nephropathy primary. Now, how do you choose to take a patient into which study would be one question that I would want to ask. But more important, you brought out this role of anti-PLA2R antibody. Tell me, what is the standardization or harmonization of lab reports of this antibody? Do you believe in all lab reports that come from wherever? Or there are any standard ELISA tests that you are going to recommend? And if laboratories are following different kits and different batches of things, are the results comparable?
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. And both the questions are very good questions. First is, how do you decide the treatment? at this point of time, we have a randomized controlled trial of reduced dose of steroids and cyclophosphamide versus the standard cyclophosphamide and steroids study going on in our institute. In patients who are willing to get randomized to the group, then we enroll them in the study. In patients who refuse for a regular follow-up or who wish not to, you know, take cyclophosphamide and steroids for one or the other reason, we offer them rituximab as the treatment. And among the rituximab, at this point of time, we are using the 1 gram on day 0 and day 15. And at the third month, we assess the anti-PLA2R. And if it is positive, we top them again with further dose of rituximab. Coming to the standardization of laboratories, sir, we were initially doing it ourselves in our lab itself. Then PGA has now started the commercial testing. And we do get reports from SRL and LAL pathologies. But I have essentially, to be honest with you, sir, I haven't done any comparison of the reports from the labs. We believe that there have been few differences. There have been minor differences in the titers, but I haven't seen any contrasting titers with us and the reports that the patients carry from outside.
The question was that whether if a patient has come to us, we did it in our lab, then he goes somewhere else and sends a report from there. Are these comparable? That was the question. And is there any harmonization to say that a given particular kit for ELISA is better?
Yes, sir. So I'll take the second question first, sir, regarding the kits. Sir, there is only one kit which has been recommended by the FDA and it has been used by most of the centers. That is by the Euroimmune. So that is an FDA approved kit for the assessment of PLA2R antibodies. Coming to your first question is there any harmonization of reports? Usually what happens is patients do carry reports of PLA2R when they come to us from an outside lab. And we always draw a sample before we give immunosuppressive therapy to them. And what we have found is there are variations. They are variations. Suppose it's 200 with us, it may be 250 or 260. We have not found, you know, titers in the plus or minus 20 range at all. But yes, but we have never found that we have found one patient who is 200 and, you know, the patient comes from outside with a report of less than 14. We have not found such antagonizing reports. But yes, there are variations. Probably that is probably related to the time period also, because the samples are not drawn at the same point of time. There may be a time gap of around 15 to 20 days. And also, you know, the intricacies of doing the testing differs.
The other comment I had on the first case that you said, contraindication to biopsy.
Yes.
I would take up being a devil's advocate there and say, well, you do the biopsy and then use anticoagulation if there is no bleeding complication in, say, 24 hours time, you're not losing really much.
Yes, sir. So, if you, I can share my slide.
So that, how long does it take for you to get the PLA2R report? What is the turnaround time,
sir,
in the labs that, I mean, when you have a captive lab of your own, you can ask them to do it quickly. But if the number of samples coming to a particular lab are not many, they do it on certain days. So therefore, you need to know what is the turnaround time for it. That's why my question.
Yeah, perfect, sir. So the turnaround time in PGA is about 2 weeks. I think the turnaround time in the private laboratories, some of the private laboratories, 1 week, I think they do it every Fridays or something like that. The turnaround time with in PGA is about 2 weeks. And your opinion of, you know, starting the patient on unfractionated heparin, doing the biopsy, and this is what we have been following all the years. But yes, when we had the test available and we were going to run the kit the very next day. So that was the time we decided to take this blood sample and then undertake his test. So that was the reason, you know, it looked very easy, but you know, it was only possible because we were running our test the very next day.
Well, Raja, again, you're very good at answering too, as you are at presenting. One final question that I would want all the PGs to understand and listen is that if you are going to immunosuppress your patients, apart from testing for hepatotropic viruses, also for secondary work of connective tissue disease and malignancy, I would very strongly advocate ruling out tuberculosis in our country and presence of active infection, dental, ENT, which are often hidden. And if you use immunosuppression, I think a thorough examination and looking for infections before immunosuppressing patients is something which I would add to your presentation. I don't know. Perfect. What do you think?
Perfectly. So well taken, sir. Well taken. You know, these are words of wisdom, sir. You know, I just cannot challenge this. You know, that I fully agree with you, sir. That is why they say that, you know, you need to do a good clinical examination, an ultrasound assessment, a chest X-ray, and you just cannot, you know, ignore, you know, the subtle signs of tuberculosis in the patients. I agree with you.
One final thing.
Yeah.
After you've done all this, you treated them with immunosuppressive medications and you have faced complications of immunosuppression once and all. So you will get some patients who are not responding and are getting complications of immunosuppression. And there you are forced to go back to the yesteryears where you're only going to manage the nephrotic state. So what are your thoughts on that for such patients? Because in practice, I believe you will face such a problem, the students and everybody.
Yeah. So very well taken, sir. And you know, your comment and question, both of them, sir. If you go to the side effect profile, for the cyclical cyclophosphamide, 2/3 of the patients have some or the other side effect to the cyclophosphamide. Although the serious adverse events is seen only in 15% of the patients. But yes, some, and coming to the resistant cases, you know, about 20% of the patient do not respond to cyclical cyclophosphamide and steroids. And what do we do when these patients are really not tolerating any immunosuppression? I would largely agree with you. We just put them on diuretics and then ACE/ARBs. And membranous nephropathy, as we all know, is not a disease which would rapidly progress to end-stage renal disease. It's going to take some time, even if you don't treat them. So if you see Dr. Jha's study, you know, only at the end of 10 years, 50% of the patients progressed to ESRD. 50% of them did have renal functions, albeit with some compromise. So yes, if the patients are not tolerating any immunosuppression, I can vaguely recover at least 5 patients of ours who are not on any immunosuppression because they did not tolerate any dose of steroids. They developed reactions to rituximab, henceforth, and with CNI, they developed an increase in serum creatinine. We had to withhold all forms of treatment in them. We also tried azathioprine in them. You know, 2 of them developed leukopenia to azathioprine, although it's not a recommended treatment. You know, sometimes when you're pushed to wall, you try to use all sorts of treatments. All the two out of the 5 patients developed leukopenia to azathioprine. We just left them to themselves and, you know, hope they would have a spontaneous remission at some point of time.
Well, would you take...
Should I take the question one by one, sir? Should I take questions one by one?
I'm just going to make one more comment. That in such cases, I would personally consider using the maximum tolerated dose of ACARBs, provided they are available and they have an access to creatinine and potassium.
Yes, sir.
And you're monitoring the increase in dose with titrating to proteinuria.
Yeah. Yeah,
so I think you should take the questions now.
Yeah. So, I'll be reading the questions and then, you know, try to answer them as quickly as possible. How do you monitor a patient with diabetic nephropathy plus PLA2R positive or negative membranous nephropathy? So anybody, whenever a diabetic patient presents with massive proteinuria, our protocol is to do a biopsy in them. And how do you monitor the patient? See, the monitoring is going to be the same. Like, you know, after you see them for 3 to 6 months of ACE/ARBs, if they don't respond, you start them on immunosuppressive. Yes, the question here is about the immunosuppressive agents. I would refrain from using cyclophosphamide and steroids in the diabetic patients and would use rituximab or cyclosporin in them. With rituximab available freely and economical, I think rituximab would be the first drug of choice in patients with diabetic. And the monitoring would be both by the clinical and as well as serological. Clinical is proteinuria, serum albumin, serum creatinine, and immunological is the anti-PLA2R antibodies at the end of at least 3 and 6 months of therapy infusion. Is there a term idiopathic nephropathy equivalent to primary membranous nephropathy by Dr. Dilip Jadhav? I think, you know, the term idiopathic is no longer used. It's primary membranous nephropathy, and we say it as PLA2R related, thrombospondylin related, exostosin related membranous nephropathy. The term idiopathic is largely refrained from using. The next question is by an anonymous attendee who says that what would So you will very well have time for the immunosuppressive to act. It takes only 3 months. It takes the total duration of anti-HCV therapy is only 3 months, and the patients are usually negative by 15 days of therapy. If the patients continue to remain anti-PLA2R positive at the end of 3 months of the antiviral therapy, you can then start immunosuppression. Please do not start immunosuppression prior to antiviral therapy. It could backfire badly. The next one by Dr. Sakti Selvakumar is, would rituximab combined with CNI therapy advisable? A very good question. I'm sorry I'm fast because I have a lot of questions to answer. Yes, there is a trial by name the Starman trial, which is going to be presented in a couple of days in the American Society of Nephrology, where they had given tacrolimus for 6 months and then a shot of rituximab and compared it to modified Ponticelli regimen. And though we do not know the results, but yes, the authors did say that, you know, cyclophosphamide was superior to the rituximab-based therapy. And the current wisdom is the use of CNIs in primary membranous therapy should always be as a sequential therapy. That is, you use tacrolimus and then rituximab, or you give rituximab and continue using, you know, CNIs and not use CNI alone. So yes, rituximab with CNI is an advisable form of therapy. Then third is by Dr. Prabhat Chauhan. I think there is one by this name even in our unit. Is there any threshold of PLA2R to decide between modified Ponticelli versus rituximab? Yes. The initial results did say that if the patients had very high antibody titer, you know, of more than 150 to 200, they are not going to do very well with rituximab, and they may be candidates for cyclophosphamide and steroids. But subsequent results did say that, you know, these kind of patients, when you use rituximab, you need to systematically deconstruct them. The systematic deconstruction means, you know, you give one or two doses of rituximab, you need to repeat the anti-PLA2R titer at the third month, give one more dose, maybe at the 6 month, assess the CD19 and PLA2R. If it is still high, give one more dose. So it's a systematic deconstruction. Yes, you can use rituximab, but yes, in patients with high PLA2R titer, modified Ponticelli is a preferred option. And next by an anonymous attendee, please highlight PLA2R testing by ELISA and indirect immunofluorescence, which is better, and the one used by Mentor. So I think it's a very good question. I think you can use both ELISA and indirect immunofluorescence. Immunofluorescence is a more sensitive test compared to ELISA for anti-PLA2R assessment. If you want to decide the therapy, you know, termination, whether you need to start the next therapy or not, you could use indirect immunofluorescence as it is a more sensitive. It would pick up the antibodies better. And the one used in Mentor is a separate kit which the authors had designed themselves. I think it was designed by Beck, and it was not the conventional Euroimmune ELISA which was performed. The next question is by an anonymous attendee. In severe nephrotic syndrome, adding CNI initially with rituximab, yes, this is what you call as a sequential therapy. Give tacrolimus for 6 months, and at the end of 6 months, you give a shot of rituximab, the results of which would be known in a day or two, which is the Starman trial. Is there any role of cath and methotrexate? Next is by Dr. Ashwin Patel. Is there any role of cath and methotrexate in primary membranous nephropathy? You know, I will declare my ignorance to answer this question because I'm not aware of any studies which have used, I don't know what is cath and methotrexate in primary membranous nephropathy. So next is by an anonymous attendee, which says that use of CD19 measures routinely. Yes. Initially, when we were using rituximab therapy, we did use the CD19 as a target. But now I believe that it is more than the CD19. It is the anti-PLA2R we need to measure. So anti-PLA2R is a better modality to decide the next dose than the CD19. We did use CD19 in our studies because we were ignorant at that point of time. Next is by Dr. Ashwin Patel, the role of ACTH. You know, the ACTH, you know, they have been the best marketers. You know, they were into avatar business, so they know how to run their show. I'm not aware of any successful use of ACTH in any large randomized trials. Dr. Mihir Kumar, so higher PLA2R is not a contraindication to rituximab. Yes, higher A2R is not a contraindication, but you need to use multiple doses of rituximab. In higher PLA2R, you choose cyclophosphamide or rituximab. I think I've answered this question. PLA2R pleiotropism, only research level issues or any practical relevance. I think I have spoken enough on this topic. I would not take this question. And next is by Dr. Atul Kumar Hanvate. How early can we monitor anti-PLA2R antibodies after treatment with cyclophosphamide and steroids versus rituximab? You can monitor them even the very next day. But I think the wiser time would be at the 3rd and the 6th month and the 12th month. They are the best time to know how the antibodies are going about. And you can, you know, increase or decrease the dose or plan the next dose, next immunosuppressive regimen based on the anti-PLA2R titer. Next is by Dr. Payal. IAF or ELISA for PLA2R testing? I think I've answered. IAF is a more sensitive test, but ELISA would give you numerical values, which is easy to monitor. So if you want to decide or stop therapy, use indirect immunofluorescence. And for monitoring, I think ELISA is better. Next by Dr. Payal alone, is there any rituximab in PLA2R negative primary membranous nephropathy? I think the PLA2R negative and the positive membranous nephropathy behave the same way. You know, 20% of the membranous nephropathy are PLA2R negative. I didn't find any significant differences between a PLA2R positive and a PLA2R negative membranous nephropathy. Next is by an anonymous attendee. Any AC or ARB is more preferred than others, or is it a class effect? I'm not aware of any good studies which has addressed this question, and I would say that, you know, we could use any either of them. You could use an ACR ARBs, or we have also used a combination of AC and ARBs, but you need to keep a look at the creatinine and also at the potassium levels. Next is by an anonymous attendee. How do you define remission in a case of diabetic nephropathy plus membranous nephropathy? I think any reduction in the the proteinuria and an improvement in serum albumin over 3.5, I think would qualify for a remission. And yes, you know, you could get better remissions, like complete remission, you know, that would be very easy then. But yes, at least 50% reduction in the proteinuria and serum albumin over 3.5, it means that you've done a job as a nephrologist or the justice to the patient. Next is by Dr. Karthikeyan M. Are patients in whom you start immunosuppressive straight away without waiting for 3 to 6 months? Yes, as I told, in patients who do not have renal dysfunction, or patients who do not have DVT, patients who do not have recurrent infections, in them you need to wait for 3 to 6 months. And in the cohort that I explained, renal failure, DVT, recurrent infection, refractory anasarca, inability to tolerate ACARBs, you know, there you right away start immunosuppression. This is by Dr. Kamakshi Narula. I think she's from Delhi. Is there any cutoff of anti-PLA2R to decide severity of the disease? You know, what we did was we assessed anti-PLA2R in 114 patients. And based on a third of them, we decided the tertiles. You know, less than 120 was the first tertile, 120, 240 second, and more than 240 was the third tertile. More than third tertile means a severe disease. And, you know, they are less likely to respond to immunosuppressive therapy. Can we customize the duration of modified Ponticelli based on responses? There have been multiple modifications to the modified Ponticelli regimen, but I think I do not have any evidence to, you know, or any study to, you know, base my judgment. But yes, people have used. I also demonstrated a case where we used it only for 3 months, but yes, that was with anti-PLA2R monitoring, and we did show that the patient was anti-PLA2R negative at the end of second and third month, so we stopped the modified Ponticelli halfway. I think the next is by an anonymous attendee. For patients treated by tacrolimus and having partial limiting, how long should we continue tacrolimus? A very good question. There was a study from the Spanish group which did use 1 year of tacrolimus followed by 6 months of tapering. And what they showed that, you know, when I use CNIs, you should use it for at least 12 to 18 months and the taper should be slow. But yes, you run a risk of 50% relapse. I think coming to the last question by Dr. Sapna, is there any upcoming role of SGLT2 inhibitors as an antiproteinuric alone or as an add-on? Yes, you know, there have been some evidence that, you know, the patients with the IgA nephropathy and other glomerular disease in the DAPA-CKD, did show a reduction in the proteinuria. I think going mechanistically, I think there would be a reduction in the proteinuria when you use SGLT inhibitors, but I'm not aware of any studies and I have not yet started to use them in our unit. Thank you. I think I've taken up almost most of the questions. And if there is anything, you can just write to me. I'll be happy to reply.
Sir, just pardon me, but one last question has come up also by Dr. Prabhat Chauhan. Any threshold for PLA2R titers prior to transplant?
So, you know, again, there have been no randomized trials which says that what you need to do when patients with PLA2R titers prior to transplant. My personal experience has been that patients who have high antibody titers, I can at least tell you three clinical scenarios that I have encountered. There have been three patients. One had a titer of around 400 who underwent a transplant, had a recurrence within 2 months. His mother was an extended criteria donor. And then, you know, the patient had recurrence of the disease, some chronicities, and the graft was lost by 8 months. The second had a titer of 200. The patient had recurrence in the second week. But however, within the next 6 months, the antibody vanished away. And then, you know, the patient had a proteinuria of less than 500 milligrams. The third patient had a titer of 120 prior to transplant. And this patient did not have any recurrence of the disease. So I believe that the patients in the second and third tertile, they would have recurrences. And in the first tertile, you know, the immunosuppression steroids, tacrolimus, MMF should take care of the illness. We essentially do not know what we should be doing prior to transplant. But yes, a word of caution should always be expressed in patients who have very high titers of antibody, which is very unlikely in CKD patients because, you know, membranous nephropathy, they have a long course prior to CKD SRD.
Well, I think, Raja, you covered everything very, very well. I must congratulate you for doing an excellent job. I don't think I could have done anything better than this.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
So over to Joytosh, whatever.
Yeah.
And Vijay, sir. Comments from Dr. Vijay Kher. I think we should ask for that.
I agree with you that I think Raja has done an exceptional. And that's what was expected from him, actually. And his original work. And I heard him many times on this topic. And I had no hesitation in telling that this would be a masterly presentation. And I thank you, Raja, for that wonderful. And I must thank you also for bringing out some of the twists which clinical you will face. And ACE and ARBs, I can recall many patients who had received multiple kinds of immunosuppressive drugs. Yeah. And finally, they come and they still remain. And the only thing that you do is remove all the immunosuppressive drugs, put them on ACE and ARBs. And so, lo and behold, surprisingly, many of them would respond and they will feel better. Even if they don't respond, they will feel better because you do the adverse effects of the immunosuppressive drugs that might happen. And sometimes you create that. And I think it was very well brought out by you, Mohan, and I'm extremely thankful to both of you for bringing out actually what we intended to do in this kind of forums. And I think it highlights that if you pick up, and these are mentors which have been picked up not by me, actually the students themselves have picked up these mentors, both you and Raja, and they wanted, it's only that I picked up a topic which is relevant, which Raja would have done exceptionally. I'm sure he will do well in any other topics as well, but this is his primary research work and he's published extensively in this. And Mohan is, as usual, always charming and wise. And thank you. Thank you, Mohan. Thank
you. You're very kind to say that.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you for kind words.
Partnering with Kidney Education and Research Network, through which we are bringing you all this. And we hope to continue to see you with more speakers and more mentors. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Okay.
So, sir, at the end, our heartfelt gratitude to Dr. Vijay Kher, sir, to Raja Purkar, sir, and Dr. Raja Ramchandran, sir, for taking out your time and giving this very erudite presentation on this particular topic. And our sincere thanks to all the attendees also who took part in this session. And And I hope that you have, you must have found answers to many of your queries, and you must have found answers. I mean, it would have very much relevant to your practical scenarios which you face. And with this, I would hope that you have, just the way you have enjoyed this session, I hope that you will be enjoying our upcoming sessions also, which we will be planning and sharing with you very soon. So that is it from my side. So with the with your permission, Kher sir.
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Thank you, sir.
Bye-bye.
Okay. Good night.